Learning medicine is hard work. Osmosis makes it easy. It takes your lectures and notes to create a personalized study plan with exclusive videos, practice questions, and flashcards, and so much more. Try it free today.
Clostridia, as a family, are obligate anaerobes, meaning that oxygen is toxic to them. In nature, they thrive in deep, compact soil, and when they feel the stress of fresh, oxygenated air, they often produce spores, which are metabolically inert and extremely resilient to the environment. Then, when the environmental conditions improve, the spores are able to sprout into fully fledged Clostridia. When doing a Gram stain, Clostridium botulinum stains purple, or Gram positive, and it's a bacillus, meaning that it looks like a big cylinder or rod under the microscope. Clostridium botulinum is notorious for producing a toxin, called botulinum toxin, which causes botulism. Historically, to preserve foods, processes like sausage making and canning became popular. Unfortunately, these environments block out air. If a Clostridium botulinum spore gets in during the food preparation process, it can grow and produce botulinum toxin, contaminating the food. In fact, this is how Clostridium botulinum gets its name, since botulus means sausage in Latin. When it infects a can, the can begins to bulge with air, because the bacteria has metabolized sugars into short-chain fatty acids that form a gas. And although the short-chain fatty acids are mostly made up of carbon dioxide and hydrogen, the gas is particularly foul-smelling. Now, nerves that use the neurotransmitter acetylcholine are those we use for muscle control. Upon ingesting a contaminated food product, botulinum toxin works by binding specifically to these nerves, inhibiting muscle contraction. The toxin comes in 8 distinct types, named A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and H, and they vary in their toxicity. The neuron takes in the botulinum toxin by endocytosis, creating a small vesicle that floats within the neuron's cytoplasm. The toxin then activates and slips out of the vesicle and starts to cleave snare proteins. Snare proteins tug vesicles containing acetylcholine to the plasma membrane, where they get released into the synapse, and transmit a signal to the muscle. Without snare proteins, acetylcholine doesn't get released, so no signal is sent out by the affected nerves. The result is that the muscle gets completely relaxed and flaccid. Muscle weakness usually starts in the muscles supplied by the 12 cranial nerves, so the muscles that control the face, eye movements, chewing, and swallowing. In addition, nerves of the autonomic nervous system that rely on acetylcholine are also affected. Early on, botulism can cause a bulbar palsy, or impairment of cranial nerves 9, 10, 11, and 12, and over time, there may be a descending paralysis. Symptoms of botulism include double vision, drooping of the eyelids, an inability to make any facial expressions, and difficulty swallowing. In addition, because of the autonomic nervous system effects, it can cause dry mouth, postural hypotension, or low blood pressure while standing, nausea, vomiting, and constipation. Often, the symptoms of botulism can progress to complete flaccid paralysis, which can be deadly if it involves the respiratory muscles. The diagnosis of botulism is primarily based on a serum analysis for the botulinum toxin. Growing Clostridium botulinum in culture is rarely successful because anaerobes are difficult to grow in a lab setting. Treatment of botulism is mostly supportive, and the goal is to assist the affected patient in breathing. In adults, botulism can also be treated by passive immunization with an antitoxin. Two types of antitoxin exist: a trivalent one, which covers toxins A, B, and E, and a heptavalent one covering toxins A, B, C, D, E, F, and G. The purpose of antitoxin is to catch the free toxin molecules in the bloodstream before they can damage the neuronal proteins. Now, most canning processes undergo high-pressure cooking, which is like autoclaving, and reliably destroys the toxin and sterilizes the contents of the can. Other preserved foods can be conserved by high acidity or low pH, for example, pickles. The most common form of food-related botulism is infant botulism, or floppy baby syndrome. Newborns and infants still have poorly developed gut flora, and their gut is vulnerable to colonization by Clostridium botulinum. Colonizing bacteria will continue to produce their toxins directly in the intestine, causing botulism. Honey has been implicated as a potential vector for transmitting Clostridium botulinum spores and should be avoided in children under 12 months. Finally, two types of botulinum toxin, A and B, are less toxic and can reliably induce long-lasting neuromuscular junction block, so they are sometimes diluted and injected into a rigid muscle to relax it. Other diseases that can be improved with botulinum toxin are hyperhidrosis, or excessive sweating, achalasia, and focal dystonia, which is when there's an involuntary spasticity in a muscle group. Botulinum toxin is also used as Botox in aesthetic surgery to help smooth out wrinkles for a few months. All right, as a quick recap, Clostridium botulinum is an obligate anaerobe that makes spores and secretes a botulinum toxin, which causes botulism. Spores are usually found in badly preserved food and honey. Consumption of food contaminated with botulinum toxin can lead to neuromuscular block and flaccid paralysis that may be lethal through suffocation without supportive treatment.
Thanks for watching. If you're interested in a deeper dive on this topic, take a look at osmosis.org, where we have flashcards, questions, and other awesome tools to help you learn medicine. Otherwise, you can always support us by donating on Patreon, subscribing to our channel, or following us on social media.